Ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank you so much for being here this evening. It is really an honor and a pleasure to have you here to share this. To share this amazing night with you. Last year, I was a whopping 40 weeks pregnant. And I had a lot of fun and I went into labor the next day. So it was a good party. We're going to try to make it that again. I'm getting directions to stay away from these people. Thank you. I appreciate that. So we're going to go ahead and get the program started. I appreciate everybody's patience. It's going to be a wonderful evening. We're going to get through the formalities and then get to the party, because that's what I like. Ladies and gentlemen, this organization, even today in its infancy, has already made a dramatic impact in so many lives, not just Cape Verdeans in Cape Verde, but also Cape Verdeans in the United States, and given so many the opportunity to give back to their communities with their amazing talent and generosity. And I'm so glad to have been invited back to host this event, because it's such a special honor to me, but it's also an honor to be able to thank the individuals who make this happen every single year. So if we could just give them a quick round of applause, they know who they are. So just in the past few years that the organization has been practicing, already in Cape Verde, they've treated over 600 patients in the clinic, and they have performed over 60 surgeries in Cape Verde. These are people that do not have access to that kind of healthcare and the kind of specialties that the doctors and nurses and CNAs and everybody who participates, they don't have access to this openly and readily available as we're able to provide. They've performed surgeries as simple as a hysterectomy. I know that sounds simple to some people, but it's complicated to me, okay? And then surgeries as complicated as a fistula. I don't even know where to start with that, but there are plenty of doctors in the room who can explain it to you if you are curious, okay?
Leave it at that.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll leave it at that. I got some good advice over here. Ladies and gentlemen, leadership is not an affair of the head. Leadership is an affair of the heart. And the person I would like to introduce first, who will kick off the program, actually the first two individuals, have been instrumental in the success of this organization. These men are humble. They're amazingly gifted and talented. Clearly they're smart because they got through medical school. It's not an easy feat. Ladies and gentlemen, first I would like to bring to the stage Dr. Michael Kearney and Dr. Peter Chen.
We'd like to thank you all for being here. It's been a phenomenal 7 years, how things have grown. We'd like to give you an overview on Project Health CV. The organization was founded to offer ongoing medical education, resource support to the Cape Verdean healthcare system, to facilitate and assist healthcare providers to develop and implement individual healthcare programs in Cape Verde, and to provide world-class healthcare to those that don't have healthcare. So for those of you that are not from Cape Verde, where is Cape Verde? Follow the arrow. It's off the hump of Africa, the west coast of Africa. It's an archipelago of 10 islands. Believe it or not, there are one or two nonstop flights from the Boston, Providence area a week that go to the capital, Praia. It historically was a Portuguese colony that gained its independence roughly 40 years ago. Two-thirds of the population live outside of Cape Verde, and they're incredibly involved in giving back to their country. Just take a look around this room right here. And these are the people that give back to their country, everybody. the long-standing ties to New England start as a seafaring nation, now via airplanes. I came to know my dear friends from Cape Verde through the relationship that the Beth Israel Deaconess has with the Bowdoin Street Community Health Center, along with the Interpreter Center, the Interpreter Service Program at the Beth Israel Deaconess. I was responsible for running the general urology clinic at the Beth Israel Deaconess starting in 2005 to the present, and that's where I developed my relationship with my dear friends who are here tonight and are the ones that have made everything happen. So, I'll give you a little history of the project LCB. So in 2010, after several years of, Tina, where are you? Can you please stand up? I won't go through the other 12 to 14 dear friends that are interpreters here that every week would come to me in the clinic and say, you know, Mike, we should go to Cape Verde. We could go there and we could do something. And so after 3 to 4 years of this, I said, well, maybe we can go. And they said, great, we're going to book the flights. We're on the plane. And I said, I think I have to be an older doctor to actually do this. And I said, no, you don't have to do that. It's all going to work out. And I said, that's fine. So myself and Ernestina and my dear friend Luis, who's down in Florida, and Abubakar Balde, and two fellows, we got on a plane out of Logan, and you'll see our pilot here, which some of you Cape Verdeans will know, wearing the Nike hat, and the next thing I knew, I woke up and I was in Cape Verde. And I said, how is this going to work? And here's how it really works. If you look in the middle, that's the ex-president of the country. And everybody here is connected and they know each other. And they care about their country and they give back. And so the doors opened. We came through customs. We had boxes full of stuff that we had saved up. And just miraculously, things happened. So, you know, this is the island of Santiago. The capital praia at the bottom is where the flight lands. Tina, her family, and a lot of the relationships are from the middle of the island, which is called Asamata. And you go over this rocky, mountainous area, switchback roads. Some people can't handle it, they get a little sick. And so we brought a lot of supplies. We literally unloading boxes full of catheters and various different supplies. And we're driving by the emergency room. This is actually the emergency room in Praia to Asamata. And this is what a clinic looks like there. Patients, you know, will wait for days, unlike in America where they're upset that I'm 20 minutes late. And don't understand and stomp their feet. In Cape Verde, they, you know, will wait hours and hours and hours and be incredibly grateful. And so these are the rooms that we saw patients in. So that first year, we only went for 4 days. Literally, we flew in with four interpreters, the three of us. We saw 150 patients prearranged. We were able. With the local physicians there that are very accomplished, general surgeons, not a lot of urological subspecialty. We did the first transurethral resection, which is for men that can't urinate, that are living with tubes out of their abdomen. And there's another gentleman that had an open stone procedure. His kidney was blocked. And we were, for what we take for granted here, small telescopic procedures, there, the only option was open surgery, and we performed that. And we left saying, you know, we can do a lot more. We can come back. So I came back and I said to myself, how can we do things better? How can we how can we improve things? And this gentleman here, Dr. Peter Chang, was actually my resident and then fellow, and now is my partner and is now an accomplished robotic surgeon at the Beth Israel Deaconess Hospital 7 years later. But he said, Mike, we can go. And I'll let Peter kind of take over from here.
Thanks, Mike. Well, you know, I owe the incredible relationships and friendships that I've built over the last 7 years with folks in Cape Verde to Michael and to Tina and to so many of the other interpreters that I've had the privilege of working with in the clinics. And it's truly been a privilege to be part of this organization and to see what it's been growing into. And I'm just going to give a brief overview of how things changed over the last 5 or 6 years. I've actually been on a trip about four to five times, and it's been just an amazing experience. 2011 was the first time I went. Like Michael said, I was my last year of my residency at the time, and it was very eye-opening to go to Cape Verde and to see the incredible need that was there and that continues to be there. It really offered a tremendous amount of perspective. In the training that I was getting here in the States and the things that I was doing just seemed so seemed so trivial in some ways compared to what we could accomplish over there to So in 2011 we went there for 7 days. We had more urologists, we had more interpreters, and we actually saw more patients. We saw about 300 plus patients, performed 18 operations, and started to come in here, you know, more than one operating room at the Hospital Santiago Norte. And in 2012, what you can notice in these slides is that at the bottom we're going to talk about the number of patients, but soon you're going to start to notice that this mission aspect in which, can you guys hear me? You guys can't hear me? Okay, sorry. So what you're going to start to notice is that this mission aspect in regards to us operating on patients and seeing patients is going to become a little bit less of an emphasis because actually the project grows. And I think that's really important, and that's going to be one of the focuses of why you are all here today. So in 2012, we again went for 7 days, four urologists. We added the very important urogynecology component here with Dr. Michael Feb and Amos Adeloa. And this is where we started to offer more help to the women of Cape Verde. 8 interpreters went. We saw a certain number of 200 plus patients, and again, the new addition of 100 plus urogynecology patients and performed 24 operations. And then this relationship that we built with some of the Cape Verdean surgeons there, including Dr. Semedo, was wonderful. It was really about, we started to see that this was not so much about a mission that we would have to go there and operate there once a year, that wasn't enough. It really was about trying to do our best to contribute to the Cape Verdean health system. And we were very privileged to work with Dr. Elsa Semedo at the time, and she actually came to visit us at the Beth Israel to see how things worked here and how she could learn from what we had here to bring it back. And our missions continued. And you see now that's kind of on the bottom of the slide, because not to underemphasize the importance, but really to show that there's more and more building. In 2014, the trauma surgery program with Dr. Steve Odom and Dr. Nicole Ricard came on a trip to start to establish their roots there as well. That equipped program, Drs. Campbell and Rosenblum, who you can see here, also came along. And we started to build a formalized relationship with the Cape Verdean Ministry of Health. And so this relationship became less of a relationship between our organization at Israel and a select number of Cape Verdean citizens to actually becoming something that's national. And again, the missions continue. In 2015, with the help of so many of the folks here, especially Tina, Project Health CV as an organization was formed as a 501c3 nonprofit organization. And Dr. Raykar continued his work with the Lancet Commission on Global Health. And we had Cape Verdean surgeons and urologists actually visit us here at the IGC to see how we worked here. And again, we visited with urology, urogynecology, and trauma. Again, going down to last year, in 2016, we had, as many of you were here, our first winter gala, in which over $25,000 were raised. And later on in this talk, Michael's going to share with us, just, you know, to really share with us how much that made a difference to this organization and to the people of Cape Verde, and how much we thank you for your donations. Just as an example, two new ureteroscopes, which are advanced urologic equipment, was that we bought a holmium laser, which is also a piece of equipment that's very difficult and very expensive to get. It was the first one ever to come to Cape Verde, and that was bought there. And some new video towers as well to hopefully set up the future and perhaps even consider an invasive surgery in Cape Verde. On a Saturday, there were approximately 50, probably about 50 to 80 doctors and nurses from Cape Verde that took time out of their weekend to come and see us give some lectures in Cape Verde. This was really a special event because this was something in which we were able to just talk about basic urology, and the reception was just wonderful to be able to speak. And I think this is something that's going to start the teaching aspect and hopefully giving us to actually give to the medical community, not just patients there, and hopefully continue the relationship there. And again, the mission continued. I want to point out these bottom two pictures here. This machine here is the holmium laser, which is what we use to break up kidney stones in the ureter and the kidney. And this arrived in a ship, shipped overseas to Cape Verde. And when we went on our trip in 2016, it was not yet unloaded off the dock. But when Dr. Kearney went back later that year, it had been unloaded. This is just an interesting story in which, you know, you see Dr. Mario here with the laser. But what they couldn't find was you need to actually turn on the laser. And in order to turn on the laser, you need a key. And there was no key. But we have Dr. Lefebvre here, who has certain skills. So with his help, they were able to pick the lock of the laser. And we're able to do the first two ureteroscopies ever performed in Cape Verde. And the key is in the hands of Cape Verdeans now, is that this will no longer, your services will no longer be needed. I want to turn over the mic over to my good friend and colleague, Dr. Brian Ibarra. Bryony is a fellow in Children's Hospital of Boston in pediatric urology, and she's also a colleague, and she'll be talking about some of the pediatric urology initiatives that are happening.
Thank you so much. It's with great pleasure that I'm able to speak to everybody today. I'm very excited to have joined the team. As Dr. Chang mentioned, I was a resident last year and went on my first trip with Michael Kearney and the rest of the gang, and had an exceptional experience. And at that time, I knew that I was going to be a fellow at Children's Hospital, and really wanted to see what was going on with some of the children in Cape Verde, and so we set out to do that. And I'm going to start with presenting just a unique case to just exemplify what we can really do in Cape Verde. So the year before I came, Dr. Chang and Dr. Kearney saw a 19-year-old girl, and she had been wet her entire life, so wearing pads, diapers, and basically kind of living in shame and hiding it. And nobody ever knew what the problem was, and it was just what it was. We were lucky enough at that time to have just coincided with the new CT scanner that had been purchased. And we arranged to get her a CAT scan and came back the following year and confirmed what our suspicion was, which was that she had a congenital abnormality of her ureter, which basically means that her kidney didn't, the tube that drains her kidney didn't insert into the bladder, but rather just to the outside of her body. And so all that needed to happen was to just reroute the ureter or remove the kidney, depending on what it looks like. And so this CT scanner showed us that she had a very small, small kidney on that side, probably wasn't functioning that much. And so the, really the treatment was to just remove it. And if it was removed, she'd be dry, and that's it. And so this is Dr. Chang, and I'm sitting behind him counseling her and her grandmother before the procedure. And so we went in and we did open surgery. I apologize for the non-medical folks in the room. So we went in using all the instruments that we had, we did the open surgery and we found this tiny little kidney and we removed it. And she woke up the next morning as a 19-year-old girl without any urinary incontinence. Been what we've noticed with a lot of the, our K-variant patients is that they tend to be very stoic. They don't ask for too much. They don't complain. And she was very quiet when we went and saw her the next morning. And I said, "You're dry, right? You're dry." And she said, "Yeah." I think despite how reserved she appeared, I think this was hugely monumental for her as a young woman, moving on with her life and future relationships and family and just navigating through society. We also did two hypospadias repairs and two orchidopexies, and we also removed a malformation on the glands of a little boy. But we left patients behind because there simply wasn't time or resources to do everything. But we've kept track of everybody. We have several cases listed here, both operating room cases and clinical cases that just need long-term follow-up. And so we have plans, great plans for the coming year to continue to address these conditions and figure out what's going on there. So here are some more patients just in the recovery room. We essentially determined that one of the things that we really need for moving forward is to get some pediatric instruments. And so here's sort of a list and a picture of just the few things that we're looking for that we need from that trip for this for the future. So along with just the clinical care, one of the things that we really want to push from the pediatric side, and I think everybody feels this way, to be honest, within the group, is that we really need to understand what the need is in Cape Verde. And so when we're there, we're going to be meeting with providers and talking to them and interviewing them and getting a better sense of sort of what's going on, who's doing what they really need in terms of supplies, in terms of education, in terms of the disease that they're seeing. In the pediatric realm, there are probably several children being sent over to Portugal for care that could potentially stay in Cape Verde if we provided the right support. And so we look forward to further skills training, knowledge building, clinical exchanges, potentially bringing providers here to Boston Children's Hospital, and further research and collaboration, research collaboration and mentorship.
Thank you, Dr. Kearney, Mr. Chang, and also Dr. Brady. Ladies and gentlemen, our purpose here this evening and the complexity of the information that we're relaying to you is certainly not to gross you out, number one, although it might, and it's certainly not to confuse you or make you feel like you need to learn a little something about the medical industry. It's so we can help you understand the importance of what your dollars, what your donation is going to and how it is impacting the lives of Cambodians in America and abroad. What is seen so simple to us to simply go to a clinic and get treated is a world away from possibility to some individuals in Cape Verde. I mean, you would be surprised at the response that we receive when they even know you're coming, when you land at the airport in Praia. People are already lining up. It is amazing, and we want you to know that, you know, $5, $10, $20, blessed enough to give $500, $1,000, $5,000, your dollars are all tax deductible, and they're going to impact individuals' lives. And they say that it takes a village to raise a child. Well, it takes an army to run an organization as such. And since the beginning of this organization, there are numerous individuals who have donated their own dollars to help run this organization, and we are eternally grateful. And there are numerous people who continue to do that because money does run dry, although we look at we're not rich, okay? So every single dollar counts, and we encourage if you feel compelled to give today, please give from your heart. Again, all of your dollars are tax deductible per the IRS. Code 501c3. If you're interested, please see anybody in the back of the room. They can help you. You can also donate online or anonymously if you choose. So please do so. So next up to the stage, I would like to call, these are really cool guys. Not only are they smart, everybody in the room is talented, but very funny and humble gentlemen. I'd like to welcome them to the stage now. I'm going to let him introduce himself because I can't do his name justice. Dr.
Call me Dr. Smith. It's not that hard. I'm Nigerian. I'm not Cape Verdean, but... Oh, okay. All right. Can everybody hear me?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Good evening, or bon nuit. I want to thank everybody for being here today. This is a great opportunity for a group here to have everybody here today to listen to a talk. Now, we know sometimes when we give talks like this, people get tired, and some people may get sleepy. So feel free to stand up and, you know, walk back, grab a drink, come back, you know, grab something to eat, come back and sit down. We're almost done with this part, and then we'll move on to the fun part. So when Dr. Lefebvre approached me in 2014, so Dr. Lefebvre went to Cape Verde in 2013, and he actually had the opportunity to see Cape Verde, do some needs assessment, try to figure out what exactly do women's health need in the island of Cape Verde. I always say, you know, we all hold our women in high regards, but sometimes when it comes to healthcare, we sometimes focus on our men and we forget a little bit about our women. So when Dr. Lefebvre went, he realized that actually there are a lot of women with urogynecologic conditions that, you know, in the United States could be easy fix, or they could be taken care of with not much, you know, needed care. But in Cape Verde, it's a different story. So on that trip, when he came back, he approached me and he said, look, there's a lot of opportunity to help women in the island of Cape Verde. These women have medical conditions that can be easily fixed, but due to limited resources or just lack of training, enough training, it was really difficult to provide such care. Now, the gynecologists on the island, they tried the best they could, but at the same time, they're also overwhelmed. And so there's a need to actually help do some education as well. So he was able to see how day-to-day activity in these women, how it affected their health. Women go on the field, they work in the farms, they do a lot of heavy lifting, and that results in having certain conditions called prolapse, as well as urinary incontinence in these women. But even with this, during his first trip, he was able to do some surgeries, but he felt so bad when he left because there were so many women that he could not really help. So when I went with them in 2014, I saw this problem firsthand. And as a result of our conversation with the gynecologist there, one of our aim is to not just do the surgeries, but also do a lot of training and help train some of the gynecologists there to tackle some of this condition. Because we could only do as much on a 1 week trip, but the goal is to make them self-sufficient to carry on through the rest of the year to do this. So we were able to see some of the feasibility of the surgeries we could do, as well as the training we could do on the island. We also recognized that, you know, with everything else, you know, going to a different island, going to a different country, there's some, you know, barriers that we had to face. But also, you know, not just barriers from just getting there, but also the resources that are available. So for example, we only have 2 operating rooms, and so that limits the number of surgeries you could do. When he went by himself, he recognized that he could only be at one place at one time, so he's either seeing patients in the clinic or he's in the operating room. So being able to go with a group of people where we could, you know, divide the job up and get to see more people and offer care to more people was necessary. So we also had the opportunity to take some of our fellows as well that work with us to help during that 1 week that we're there. One of the limitations also is in terms of anesthesia. You know, the island, they have a great anesthesiologist and a couple of nurse anesthetists that help them, but they could only do as much. So when Dr. Kearney is in one room, Dr. Lefebvre is in the other room, there's really nobody else to help, even if you want to do a third room. So those are some of the barriers and challenges we had. Also, we didn't really have any cystoscopy, which is a way to look into the bladder. We only had one unit, and that's either in the operating room or the clinic, so we're running it back and forth between those two locations. But as a result of the generous donations we got during the past couple of years we've been doing this, we've been able to somehow improve some of those circumstances. We've been able to get some more equipment, some more cystoscopy equipment, but the needs are still there. So it hasn't ended, and that's why we're having events such as this to create the awareness and let people know there's still so much more that will be done. Some of the cases we did when we went, prolapse, you know, for the non-medical people here, this may be graphic, but it's just a condition in women where the uterus actually falls out through the vagina. It's very uncomfortable for women. It's something that a lot of women don't talk about. But it's actually it's very bothersome for women. So some of the solution to this is very easy and straightforward. But in a place where people just don't have the resources, there's no way to offer that. Urinary incontinence is another problem that is very common there, and also the same thing. It's really, really a straightforward solution, which, you know, a lot of people in the situation where they have those resources don't even think about it. So over the years, there's been a lot of evolution since the first time Dr. Lefebvre went for the admission, and when I joined them, and we've also gone with a few of our fellows. We've been able to take more instruments, take more interested providers to help out. And we've been able to do surgical training, like we said, you know, training some of the gynecologists on the island, showing them how to do some of these procedures so that when we're not there, they could actually offer these procedures to patients. We've also had the opportunity to collaborate with Dr. Kearney and his team from a urologic standpoint, because some of these things we can't do on our own, and it's great to have them around as well to help out. I just want to end by talking a little bit about this patient. Her name is Maria. There's a lot of Marias in Verde. Just so you know, every evening when we run a surgical list, there's always like six Marias. So, just to give you a little perspective, this is an 80-year-old female that has pelvic organ prolapse, like I mentioned earlier. She's had this bothersome symptom for over 4 years, and she's actually just learned to deal with it and live a life that way. It's very uncomfortable for her, but she just didn't have any other option. And she was unable to travel to the mission in 2013 or 2014 because she came from a different island. She finally showed up in 2015 at the mission, and we did her surgery. Now, the reason I titled this "Waiting 2 years for 2 hours" is because the surgery she had done actually took about 1 hour 15 minutes, and that's all it took, 1 hour 15 minutes. And she's waited years just to go through a 1 hour 15 minute surgery that changed her life. So that is just to put things in perspective for some of the people here, is that a lot of these women are waiting years just to get a simple solution to their problem. And she actually returned in 2006 to, you know, when she brought her family just to thank us, and it was one of the greatest things to really experience. So when we talk to everyone today and we talk about the need that we have, it's not just to say we want to go, we want to do this. It's there's actually a real need, and it's of really significant importance to know that every single donation, every single support we get from everybody here today goes a long way to provide needed care. So I would like to bring Dr. Lefebvre to talk about this.
We're playing a musical microphone here. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we just wanted to remind you that there's a silent auctioning happening in the back of the room. There's everything from jewelry, beverages, skincare products, and exceptional baseball tickets. I keep saying that because I know how much, even though I don't watch baseball, I've been to a few games, I know how much those tickets cost, and if you can bid a price you'd like to pay for them today, I highly encourage you to do that. All of those gifts were donated, the majority of the gifts were donated, and all the money will go right back, reinvested into the organization in order to continue our mission and our purpose. We're going to switch up the agenda a little bit. So, next up, I'd like to introduce, first of all, I'd like to just say, I didn't even introduce myself. My name's Elsa Tavares. Thank you. I think it's a great name too. Thanks. My background is in business. I'm a former retail store manager. So our next speaker is really exciting for me because it's my realm of knowledge. It's what I do. It's what I live and breathe. I took a little bit of a break to raise my son. He's amazing. So his job is unique in the sense that his role is to promote the interaction and make a healthy environment for businesses, large and small, and entrepreneurs to conduct business. So although he's listed a little bit later in the program, I'm sure he won't mind speaking. Mr. John Barros, where are you?
Good evening, everyone. Buon night. It's good to see everyone. Is it close enough?
Yeah.
Excellent, excellent. So I wasn't expecting to speak yet. Thank you, Elsa, for the warning. But it's good to be here. I am so honored to have been asked to speak. It is amazingly intimidating to be asked to speak and not talk about saving lives after you just heard all of those speakers. So I just want to make sure we all recognize the amazing work of the community from Beth Israel with a warm, warm, warm round of applause. to Dr. Kearney, thank you for saying yes and for going on that trip and for changing lives. To all of the doctors who have joined since, thank you for believing and giving and your commitment. To those of you who helped to pick locks and help to unlock opportunities, we want to recognize all of the talents. When, as a Cape Verdean, you grow up and there are sayings, and I was born here in the United States, but there are sayings, and our elders say things to us. And sometimes when you ask somebody how they're doing, esta fra, não tem saúde, com saúde que eles também. Saúde was a big thing. Health is a big thing in our community. And just the notion of saying that, as long as I'm healthy, I'm not worried about anything else. I think everything else will kind of follow. But health is a big deal. And to be able to gift someone with their health is an amazing miracle. It's an amazing charity. It's an amazing act of love. And I'm just blown away by what I see here today. And I don't wanna, everybody else who came up here just talking about, like, you know, taking this and doing that and cutting this and pulling out, you know, livers and saving lives. And I'm just sitting there like, wow, and they do it all the time. And if you can give, give. Because I'm gonna have to write a check because I can't cut people open and save lives. But I'm really grateful for the people who can. And so that's my, I just want to observe by word the awesomeness of this project. And I want to say thank you to all of those who are involved. I want to bring official greetings from my mayor, Martin J. Walsh, who in many ways is a believer in a global community. And I want to talk about a global community today. I want to talk about the fact that we live in a very small world. And sometimes, particularly right now, the message maybe from DC might be limited in view and perspective, but in fact, we live in a very, very, very small world. We live in a global world. Our world here in Boston is very global, very international, and we count on the international community. In the same way that Cape Verdeans are beginning to count on Americans, particularly from the BI community, going to do some work. We count on Cape Verdeans being healthy, being smart, coming here, producing in Cape Verde, creating, innovating. We count on each other. We count on a global world. And I wanted to share some information as the Chief of Economic Development from the City of Boston that I've come to appreciate from the international community here in our city. We live in an amazing city. The city of the greater area of Boston is an amazing place. But it's an amazing place particularly because we've got amazing people. And we've got a lot of amazing people who were foreign born. And I want to talk a little bit about that today, the importance of that. Boston is a city of about 27% of the city being foreign born. In 2010, there were only about 20% of us that were foreign born. And in fact, we've grown rapidly since then. And before then, and we accredit being able to weather the recession by the rapid growth in our population in this area. A lot of people felt the pains of the Great Recession. But in our area, we did it. And part of that was growth. And that main growth came from immigrants. Immigrants helped to come and be part of this amazing place and even make it better. When Trump first wrote that executive order and he signed it, the first group of people that called me were high-tech CEOs. High-tech CEOs, we're growing. Companies are coming to Boston, high-tech CEOs. We've grown 60,000 jobs in Boston in the last years. in the last year. We're now at an unemployment of about 2.6%. We're doing well. But high-tech CEOs called and said, oh my goodness, if I can't get talent from overseas, I can't do business. Because they're such a part of the innovation and creativity and the way we think differently about the world, about life, and how we solve problems. And bringing them here to the United States so we can meld into all of the awesomeness that is the US and give our contribution is a part of business and a part of the vital economy that we have. It is not just about doing good. It's about all of us having a better life because we understand that we, in fact, depend on each other. Boston's economy depends on the $3.4 billion of total expenditures that immigrants spend in our economy every year. We depend on the $116 million in state and local taxes. We depend in undocumented pay taxes. I just want to say that, because there's a notion that, you know, somehow if you don't have documents, you can walk into Target, buy something, and not pay a sales tax. And it's just really, you don't have to have documents to contribute to our economy from a tax perspective. We count on the gross regional products of the foreign-born people in our city at the tune of $2.3 billion a year. These are real numbers. Foreign-born residents in our area contributed 15,000 jobs to our economy in the past 3 years. Foreign-born residents in our area, in many ways, work in the healthcare and social assistance industries at a higher rate than any other sector of our economy. I just wanted to share that, right? 30% of the folks in our healthcare sector, which is the largest job sector in our economy, are foreign-born. 30%. Some amazing, creative people. So I just want to thank you for going back to Cape Verde, to saving some of the doctors and the fellows and the interns that are going to come here soon to be part of our amazing city. So I can go on and I won't. I think you understand that the reciprocity, the feeling of connectedness to a global community, the feeling of valuing one another, and doing it in a way that's real, not just because you feel sorry for someone, but because you understand their value as a human being, and you understand their value and what the value of those who come from their country and are here and are giving and are public servants and are health providers mean for all of us, right? And so I want to turn to the Cape Verdeans in the room and say this. I'm extremely proud to be Cape Verdean. Extremely proud to be Cape Verdean. I just want to say that. And I'm extremely excited for one thing that I did this last couple of years, and that is that the mayor of Boston signed an agreement, a twinning cities agreement with the city of Praia. We are now sister cities. Boston and Pride. I want to recognize Veronica, who's here from the Consul General's office. And you're probably not here under official capacity, but you were part of the signing of that agreement. And I want to say this. We contribute a lot here, and there's a lot of us in this room. When you leave this today, go back and tell someone that doesn't know about this effort. And make sure that you tell the young people in our communities about what's going on here today and how they can give back. I don't have a lot of time, so I can't spend a lot of time on this, but as a Cape Verdean-born American, it was life-changing to go back to Cape Verde. Because, man, we're spoiled here. We are spoiled here, and we we don't take advantage of what we have. And I'd like to make sure that more Cape Verdeans are giving back. The mayor said to me one time, hey, look, because in Ireland, there's a lot of American companies bringing jobs, there's a lot of talent, there's a lot of work happening, and it's really exciting. And he said, John, Cape Verde could be the next Ireland. And I said, amen to that, and we're gonna try. Because they're doing some things. And so, but for Cape Verde to be the next Ireland, our young people need to keep our values. Our young people need to see what's going on here today. And I just wanted to just leave that message. Go back, share with the young person the amazing thing that's going on here today, and invite them in to the next gala so that we can blow out this room and go to something twice as big. So with this, I want to recognize Ms. Gonzalez, who is going to get an award afterwards. I just couldn't leave the mic without doing that because she's a mentor. She's a hero, heroine in the community. And I just wanted to say, I love you for what you do, what you've done and continue to do for our community. Thank you. And then finally this, my commitment leaving today is that the city of Boston is going to become an active partner. Where's Tina? Where's our executive director? Tina, here you go. Thank you for your leadership, Tina. The city of Boston is going to be an active partner with the project. Whatever you need, we are here for you. Thank you very much.
Much for coming at the last second. I'm sorry. And thank you so much for your humble leadership. We appreciate everything that you do for not only for Project Health City, but for the citizens of Boston as well. Thank you. So we mentioned that those of us Cape Verdean American born were spoiled, and I just want to tell a quick story. Growing up, I used to call my mother a hoarder because she'd save every single little thing. I mean, the cork or the wine she's saving. I'm like, Ma, we don't have enough space in the house to save all this stuff. So finally, when we got the opportunity to go back to CV, oh my goodness, and we saw how individuals were living and how the young kids, they were so enamored with everything that you had, and you know, they wanted to know more, they were intrigued by even just your posture, you know? And my sister and I came back, and we were like, all right, what can we say? Come on, we gotta give stuff, so next time we go, we can give kids this, we can give them that. And I'm still doing that, and now my sister's calling me a hoarder. So I appreciate everything that, all the values that she's instilled in us, and for everybody here who has humbly given and been able to give back to the young kids and the adults in Cape Verde. So next up, I'd like to introduce our executive director. She's been absolutely instrumental and part of the backbone of this organization, Ms. Ernestina de Moro Moreno.
Thank you, everyone. I do not have a speech. I know that I'm standing between dinner and everything else, so I will not take your time. My time usually is to thank everyone. But first and foremost, I want to thank the parents of Dr. Kearney. He does not like for me to do that. Thank his wife, because he's like, let me check with the wife. If she's okay, we'll go. Alexia Kearney, I thank you from the bottom of my heart to let me take your husband away. Even the twins and all the people who help my people. There's no speech, I'm out of order, but I know that John Barrows, who I know through church, everybody's like, oh, we'll get John Barrows here. I'm like, he probably doesn't recognize my name because he knows me as Titina. with Padre Zay. But I was sure that once he found out about us, he was going to come, even if it was last minute. And because of that, I want to give him a token of thank you for being here, taking time out of your crazy schedule just to make us partners with City of Austin.
Support from all of your partners that Project Health to me. Thank you.
And while we're at the awards, we have one lady here who is one of the most important ladies of Cape Verdean America. When we came to US in 1980, they didn't speak English. I fought every day in school because I thought they were calling my mom names. So we have one teacher here who was there for all Cape Verdeans who came. It didn't matter where you came from. And tonight we want to award this individual with a Lifetime Achievement Award for community service that she taught us how to do. We will call up Miss Virginia Gonzalez. She's from Brava. Again, I don't have my glasses, not because I'm over age, but
Miss Virginia Gonzalez, we thank you for your outstanding community support from all your partners at Project Health CV.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. I'm a retired teacher, and you know, we always have something to say. And I'm a senior citizen. And we always have something to say. I keep telling people that sometimes my mind tells me I'm still in my 30s, but the body reminds me that I'm 77. Nope. I say, well, what is looking 77? This is who I am. I was very surprised when Tatina called me to tell me about this. I said, why? What? Because, you know, I don't remember really doing that much for this wonderful family.
He's trying to fool you.
No, I'm very grateful to be recognized, of course, but I need to say a few words about why I feel I am who I am and I do what I do. I've been blessed in many ways, and I was blessed with wonderful parents. I come from the smallest of the populated Cape Verde Islands, Brava, and our house was on the main street. The door was always open. Everybody. And in Brava, we didn't have a hospital. We didn't have too much when I was there. If I had not come to America, my education would stop when I was 10 years old. But my mother was a type. My father was in America. My mother was a type that anybody who needed anything could always find it in her house. And one of the memories that I have is that
2 days before we left Prava, a young man who had been in our house for some 18 days because he had fallen and broken his back, died. And he was distantly related to us, but there was no hospital, no place to go. So when he broke his back and they brought him to where we lived, we lived in the center, he stayed in our house. He slept on the floor because he had a broken back and he died. And recently, his sister found my number and called me. She says, I remember when you went to America because my brother died 2 days before you left and he had been staying in your house. My father was American, always supported us, so I had a better life than my cousins and other people because of the father that I had. And my father was very education-minded. So when I came, 9 years old, started fourth grade, went all the way through, there was never any question that I was going to go on. I was just with some of my classmates preparing for our 55th reunion from college. And I had a special father. I had special parents. Because how many immigrant, minority females were going to college in 1958? It was because of them. And so whatever I do today, wherever I go, whatever influence I might have on anybody, it's because of them. So that's why I wanted to recognize them. I want to thank you to this wonderful Demora family. As I said, I don't remember what I did. Except that maybe call them and tell them there's a meeting. Or, you know, we need somebody to sing the Cabrillo National Anthem. That just comes with any of those words and everything else. But I want also to thank this organization for all that you're doing for my people. Because as I said, that young man, who's a teenager, he fell from a cliff and broke his back. I don't even think we had aspirins. So you know he suffered. So thank you. Thank you for going to Cape Verde, for all that you do for my people. And if I can help in any way, Tina knows where I am.
Just let you know a little bit of information that most of you don't know. It's 10 islands. There's 2 central hospitals, one in Praia and one in San Vicente. Then there's a regional hospital in the middle of Santiago, Asomada, where we started. But there's a regional hospital that covers Fogo and Brava. We started in the middle of Santiago where I experienced many men dying over something that now we take care of. Now I feel competent to take care of some of those things, honestly, that I didn't know. I learned them working with Dr. Kearney. We started there. Now we're growing. We are branching to all the other hospitals. For the first time next month, we will go to Cape Verde. We have a group that's going to Fogo to make an assessment at the regional hospital that covers Fogo and Brava. Thanks to many of the doctors here, Dr. Peter Chang, Dr. Odom, Dr. Lefebvre, Dr. Adeloa. I'm so excited. I have to let you know how excited I am that this year we have one of the top BI doctors, Dr. Tower. And Dr. Christopher Hotinri. I never thought I would get these guys to come to Cape Verde. I am so excited that they come in to look just like Kearney and everyone else went. I will do everything in my power to get them excited about the other. So, with your support, with you going and letting people know what we are doing, and all of us getting involved, we will change the healthcare system in Cape Verde. It's what we need the most right now. Most of you know it's culturally impossible to speak for less than 10 minutes, but I have to give it up.
Really, thank you everyone for your presence tonight and for your support. We're gonna speed things up because everyone is hungry right now. And we have some great music coming up. So I'll take the time to say two things. One, we have Dr. Celeste Royce and Dr. Chris Archery that are coming with us. This came from a meeting that we attended in February where we met with the new Prime Minister, the Minister of Health and the administration at Hospital Agostinho Nieto, and they let us know what they needed. And part of what they needed was oncology services. So Tina was able to recruit Dr. Tawa and Dr. Autry to come in and do a reconnaissance mission, essentially, to see what they can do. Also, they asked us to improve the emergency services, and this is where Dr. Stephen Odom comes in. So Steve, I'm gonna ask you to come in and let him know what you've been doing and what we're doing. And I swear after that we'll have dinner.
Hey guys, I have great news. I'll be very brief. I'm gonna get right to the point here. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Sorry. I just want to say Tina's forgotten more about being a good person than I'll ever know, so we should just applaud for her. Like, I can do surgery, but I can't work out. Things about trauma is really a collaboration. Collaboration is more important than a lot of clinical work we do. Some of the surgeons have been to the doctor, been there several times. And what?
Put the microphone.
Sorry. Okay. There. So what we want to do is really take what we have at BI. We're resource blessed. It's a cruise ship of a hospital, and we want to take some of that to Cape Verde. We want to also have Cape Verde surgeons come to us. So it's a two-way street, and we want to give them what we can. I also want to say that trauma is a disease that disproportionately affects young people. So suffering, as we heard, is extreme and can be a long, long time. Again, this is one of my favorite pictures. It's a view through the little porthole operating room window, and it shows the collaboration between our teams. And we do a lot of general surgery too, not just trauma surgery. But you can see an operating suite here at the BI, and you can see the difference on the other side. So we're working to change that resource disparity. And here's our team, part of our team on the right-hand side. You can see a resident on the left and a potential medical student on the right getting involved and working with the surgeon there. And why I'm really here is to talk to you about hypothermia, and we want one of these guys, and we want to take it to Cape Verde. Patients come into the OR cold, they leave even colder, and we want to change that. It's a silly, simple thing to fix. We can buy one of these machines for a couple of $1,000s, and we can help tens of thousands of patients, I promise. This thing is sturdy, it warms up blankets, it keeps people warm, and it solves a lot of problems. And that's really all I have to say. Thank you. Letting you guys know that we're gonna start dinner, but as a final word, the purpose of the mission is expanding from clinical care. Like Dr. Adolowo mentioned, there's so much we can do in a week, but education is gonna be key. So we're very proud that this year on Saturday, May 27th, we're gonna be hosting our second conference where we were able to invite healthcare providers from all the islands to come in, and last year we got feedback that they wanted more pictures, more videos, so we're going to provide them with the learning opportunities, and we hope to make a bigger impact through education than just through clinical care. Thank you for your attention. I know we ran over a little bit, but
so, of course, it's my job to remind you that there is a silent auction in the back of the room. Now's also a good time to go ahead and get your drink tickets for the bar outside of the room. The beautiful lady in red, or ladies in red, both of them in the back of the room, tickets are available to purchase there. Again, I wanted to remind you the importance of this evening is not only to inform you of the organization's direction, but also the importance of your financial contribution. Thank you for being here, first and foremost. But if you have questions about giving, there are many people in the room who are certainly able and willing to answer your questions. If you'd like to provide a tax-deductible donation, you can see myself, Ernestina, in the back of the room, and there are other members of the organization. But I don't know about you, I'm trying to put these spanks to work. So we're going to have dinner. I'm not shy, I'm wearing them. Okay. So we're going to start on the far side of the room here and work our way around. So ladies and gentlemen, please feel free. It's a buffet dinner. You can go ahead and grab your plates and come back to your table. Again, drink tickets are available. If you have any questions, please let us know in terms of donations. Thank you very much for your patience.
esquizofrenia.
Special for a few people in the room, but I knew this woman was somebody when I saw her walking the door, and I had to tell her how amazing she looked. I mean, don't get me wrong, everybody in the room looks amazing, right? The energy in here is incredible. But this beautiful woman has a voice of a goddess. She is so talented. I didn't know who she was, but I know who she is. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? So it's a few people's birthday in here today. Ow! They're turning 20. They wanted you to know. Where's Mr. Peter Chang? Where are you? Oh, he left. On his birthday? And cut the cake. Dr. Chang, you still in here? All right. I was told the wife is here, so he's still there. He better be here. There he is. Come on over, my dear. Miss Maria da Silva, happy birthday to you too. Come on over, my dear. We didn't forget. I don't think she heard me. Maria da Silva. I have my sources. Maria da Silva, you're really.
Elsa, it's really not too many.
We got one more birthday. Is she still here? Dr. Brady?
Good enough for you, sir.
Oh, she left. Okay. Oh, we had one more birthday. The talented Dr. Brioni is gone. But we'll have to send her the video. I want you two beautiful people to stay right here. Ladies and gentlemen, if you don't know who this wonderful woman is, you'll get to know her today. The beautiful Vanessa. Come on over here, my dear. It's not her birthday, but she's gonna do us the talent to sing happy birthday to these two beautiful people. And we have the honor to be blessed with her voice today. So come on over, take the mic, girl. You need her. This is yours.
Good night. And good evening for everyone here. She's making me shy. She's making me shy.
Parabéns a você nesta data querida. Muitas felicidades, muitos anos de vida. Parabéns a você nesta data querida, muitas felicidades, muitos anos de vida.
If you didn't know how to sing happy birthday in Creole, we'll teach you later. Just sing one of us. We got you. We got you. Come on over, Vanessa. She's gonna bless us with a few more songs. Let's get this party started, my people.
Hello, everyone.
I'm just gonna take 2 minutes to mention one thing. One of our goals tonight was to let people know how to join the organization. As you can imagine, we got a little rushed through the program, so we never got to explain this point. A lot of people have good hearts, like everyone here, otherwise you wouldn't be here, and they want to join the organization. And unfortunately, I don't want to promote the idea this is only for doctors. This is not an organization only for doctors. So what we're looking for are people with goodwill, and we will serve as the middleman for you. So if you join the organization, if you go on the website, you can fill out an application. And the application really will try to pair you up with the person with the same skill as you. So let's say you are a nurse in the recovery room. Then you have some skills that you can teach a nurse in the recovery room in Cape Verde. And our job will be to pair you up, to set you up, so that when you come, you have a purpose, you have a project. So please go to the website and visit the website, fill out the application. We will review the application and try to pair you up with the person the same level of skill that you can teach something to. So again, all are welcome. This is not just for the doctors, this is for everyone who wants to do something good for Cape Verde. Please visit the website. It's projecthealthcv.com. Okay. All right, thank you.
You guys been doing to my country. I want to say thank you to Tina. Because sometimes we travel as an immigrant daily, we got a lot of challenges. We got a lot of stuff going on until, you know, you start to get on your feet and then be able to get on your feet and do stuff for you and then still look for others that you left behind. That's a big thing. It's a big thing. I just want to say, I can't say thank you because it's not enough. song because I'm very emotional. I'm so emotional right now. So before I hang the microphone for the musicians, that musician. Woo! Thank you.
muitas nas águas. Muitas sonhava que pedra badava, badava, badava. Então que castigo, que gafanhoto já tá o meu lugar. Meu fumo, para se mama caldeirão tem a comida.
Thank you.